This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: A Fleece of Gold, 5 Lessons from the Fable of Jason and the Golden Fleece by Charles Stewart Given. Foreword: Among the smaller forces which operate upon the mind and tend toward strengthening and exalting the best ideals are little books like this. They are especially valuable when so much of the author's own experience forms a thread upon which are suspended jewels of thought and illustration serviceable to those who would see and know the best things. I have found these characteristics in this small volume, and gladly recommend it to all those who would become more familiar with what our author calls the key to that cabinet of character in which nature conceals not only the motive power of everyday life, but those latent talents and energies that, through a knowledge of self, we can bring to bear upon our lives. This book will help many who have small opportunities, in the form of time and money, to expend in the use of larger volumes. Charles Stewart Given. End of the foreword. Introduction. The Fable of Jason and the Golden Fleece is known to old and young the world around. To the latter, perhaps no other simple narrative in Greek mythology is more fascinating, nor holds a more valuable lesson, if they will but seek to learn it. But especially to the boy or young man of thoughtful mind, does the glorious adventure appeal and make its lessons obvious. By way of refreshing the memory of those who were once familiar with the myth, but who, in the practical school of experience, have lost the chord of their adventure-loving days, and also for those, perchance, who are not acquainted with the tale, a brief sketch will here serve our purpose. In Thessaly dwell a king and a queen with their two children, a boy and a girl. The holy alliance between the two royal members of the household becomes disrupted, and Nephel, the good mother, appeals to Mercury, the messenger of the gods, to assist her in secretly placing the children out of reach of their father, the king. Mercury provides a ram with a golden fleece, on which the boy and girl are placed. The shining creature springs into the air, bearing its precious burden across the sea. Unfortunately, the girl falls from the ram's back and is drowned, but the boy is landed safely on the other shore in the kingdom of Colchis. Here he sacrifices the ram to Jupiter and presents the golden fleece to the king, who places it in a consecrated grove under the care of a sleepless dragon. Now Jason is heir to the throne of Aeson, ruler of another kingdom in Thessaly, from whence the royal children started on their adventurous journey. Years have passed, however, since this remarkable incident, and Jason, being now a young man and having been told the dramatic tale of the Golden Fleece, begins to think what a glorious adventure it would be to go in quest of the royal prize. Forthwith he makes preparations for the expedition, and with a band of other lusty young heroes starts on a sea voyage toward the land of the Colchian king. It is not without difficulty, however, that they accomplish the voyage, for at the entrance of the Euxine Sea they encounter two floating islands, veritable mountains of rock, huge and shaggy, which in their tossings and heavings, at intervals come together, crushing and grinding to atoms any object that might be caught between them. But Jason and his men seized the favorable moment of the rebound, plied their oars with vigor, and passed through in safety. Approaching the royal palace, Jason makes known his mission, whereupon the king promises to relinquish the valuable possession if Jason will yoke to the plow two fire-breathing bulls and sow the teeth of the dragon. Apprehending that by this means the king seeks to destroy him, Jason pleads his cause to Medea, the king's daughter, who furnishes him a charm by which he can safely encounter the fiery breath of the beasts and the armed men that will spring up in the furrow where the dragon's teeth are sown. In his Age of Fable, Bullfinch gives us a graphic picture of the scene. At the time appointed, the people assembled at the Grove of Mars, and the king assumed his royal seat, while the multitude covered the hillsides. The brazen-footed bulls rushed in, breathing fire from their nostrils that burned up the herbage as they passed. The sound was like the roar of a furnace, and the smoke like that of water upon quicklime. Jason advanced boldly to meet them. His friends, the chosen heroes of Greece, trembled to behold him. Regardless of the burning breath, he soothed their rage with his voice, patted their necks with fearless hand, and adroitly slipped over them the yoke and compelled them to drag the plow. The Colchians were amazed, the Greeks shouted for joy. Jason next proceeded to sow the dragon's teeth and plow them in. And soon the crop of armed men sprang up, and wonderful to relate, no sooner had they reached the surface than they began to brandish their weapons and rush upon Jason. The Greeks trembled for their hero, and even she who had provided him a way of safety and taught him how to use it, Medea herself, grew pale with fear. Jason for a time kept his assailants at bay with his sword and shield, till finding their numbers overwhelming, he resorted to the charm which Medea had taught him, seized a stone and threw it in the midst of his foes. They immediately turned their arms against one another, and soon there was not one of the dragon's brood left alive. Having complied with all the conditions set forth by the king, the victor now turns with eager step toward the Grove of Mars, and seizing the golden prize makes his way back to Thessaly, rejoicing in his glorious success. End of the introduction. Part 1. The Ruling Element. Jason and his men. What constitutes a state? Not high-raised battlements or labored mound. Thick wall or moated gate. Not cities proud with spires and turrets crowned. Not bays and broad-armed ports. Where, laughing at the storm, rich navies ride. Not starred and spangled courts. Where low-browed baseness wafts perfume to pride. No, men high-minded men. With powers as far above dull brutes endued. In forest, brake or den. As beasts excel cold rocks and brambles rude. Sir William Jones. The Young Man. Jason has just stepped over the threshold into the glory of a rich young manhood. And he is careful to select for his expedition some of the choicest heroes of Greece, young, brave, and strong. It has ever been thus. Youth has always been synonymous with adventure. It is a condition which seems inherent, nature instilling into the blood of her sons the very spirit of discontent, of longing to push out from the commonplace scenes of childhood into broader domains of experience. The very books which most fascinate the boy are those which deal in thrilling tales of adventure. The wily and unscrupulous traffickers in cheap literature have ever been awake to this fact, and their highly colored productions have been flung from the vicious presses like lava from Pele to pollute the minds of the young. Why is it that Robinson Crusoe and stories of this character hold such a charm for young people, lingering in their minds long after books of a profounder type have been forgotten? It is the love of adventure. To what boy at school does not the doleful history lesson assume a more brilliant aspect when the adventures of Columbus are taken up? His interest is awakened, his imagination inspired, and he is delighted, all because again that chord in his nature has been struck, the love of adventure. Perhaps no other single painting in the art galleries at the World's Fair of 1893 attracted the attention of a greater number of people, nor awakened in so many human breasts a feeling of such intense pathos as Thomas Hovenden's painting on Breaking Home Ties. Here we have it once more, Adventure Jason setting off on his journey in search for the golden fleece of fame and fortune. The narrow path that so long has led him out into the silent acres, the fields that so many years have responded to his toil, he has forsaken. The dull
routine. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.